Hi, I'm Michael Carrere, and this is Psych Exam Review. In the previous video, we saw how we can use just one version of a normal curve, the standard normal curve, in order to estimate probabilities. And we saw how we can convert between our particular measurements, or our raw scores, and standard deviation units, or z-scores. And this is what allows us to estimate probabilities more easily. And we mostly did this using the empirical rule, or the 68-95-99.7 rule, which tells us the percentage of scores that fall within 1, 2, and 3 standard deviations of the mean of the distribution. But of course, not all z-scores are going to fall neatly at 1, 2, or 3 standard deviations. We could have a z-score of 1.72 or minus 2.16. And so, in order to know the probabilities associated with these, we won't be able to get them just by memorizing the empirical rule. And so instead, what we're going to have to do is look to a table that gives us the precise probabilities that are associated with particular z-scores. And this is what's known as a z-table, or a standard normal table. The first step for using a z-table is to make sure that you know what the z-table is presenting. They all contain essentially the same information, but there are variations in how it can be presented. So most tables will give the percentage of scores falling below a particular z-score, although some tables will give the percentage falling above the z-score, or even between the mean and the particular z-score. So it's important to check which type of table you're looking at. And for these examples, I'll be using a z-table that tells us the area under the curve below each z-score, which means it's telling us the percentage of scores that have been accounted for up to that point in the distribution. So here's an example of a z-table from ztable.com. And if you have a statistics textbook, you'll probably find a similar table somewhere in the appendices. And you'll see the values should be the same, because any normal curves have the same probabilities associated with the same z-scores. Now, this table here is in a condensed format that uses rows and columns for looking up each z-score to 2 decimal places. But you may have a table that lists each z-score to 2 digits as its own row, but obviously this would take up more space. To use a table like this, first we go to the row for the first 2 digits of our z-score, and then we find the column for the last digit of the z-score. So to find the probability associated with a z-score of 1.23, I would first find the row starting with 1.2, and then I would find the column for 0.03. And the box where this row and column meet contains the percentage of scores that fall at or below that z-score. So I can see if I have a z-score of positive 1.23, then 0.8907, or 89.07% of scores, would be at that point or below, meaning it's telling us the percentage of scores that have been accounted for up to that point in the distribution. If we wanted to know the percentage of scores falling at or above that z-score, we could just subtract this value of 0.8907 in the table from 1, since the total area under the curve always equals 1. So if we've accounted for 0.8907, or 89.07% of the scores falling below this particular z value, that means that 0.1093, or 10.93% of scores, would have to fall at or above a z score of 1.23. You might notice that this table only shows positive z values. So if we want to look up a negative z score, we can look to a different table. And this is going to show us the percentage of scores falling below a particular negative z-score. So if I wanted to know the percentage of scores falling below a z-score of minus 2.72, I would look this up in the table in exactly the same way, and I'd find that this value is 0.0033, meaning only 0.33% of scores would fall below this point. And again, we could find the value above this point by simply subtracting 0.0033 from 1. And that would tell us that 99.67% of scores would fall above a z-score of minus 2.72. Now, it's not entirely necessary to have both a positive and negative z-table. It makes it easier to look things up quickly, but it's actually redundant. Each of these is actually showing us the same exact information. So if you only had a positive z-table, you could still find the percentages associated with negative z-scores, because a normal distribution is perfectly symmetrical. So if I look up the z-score of 0.4 and I see 0.6554, this tells me that 65.54% of scores fall below a z-score of positive 0.4. If I wanted to know the percentage falling below a z-score of negative 0.4, I could subtract 0.5 from my probability. That would remove the 50% of scores below the mean, telling me that 0.1554, or 15.54% of scores, are between the population mean and a z-score of positive 0.4. Since the curve is symmetrical, this means that 15.54% of scores will also be between the mean and a z-score of negative 0.4. So if I want to find the percentage of scores below a z-score of negative 0.4, I could subtract 0.1554 from 0.5, which is the percentage at or below the mean, 50%, and I get a value of 0.3446. And if we double check our negative z table, we can see that this is the correct value for the percentage of scores falling below a z-score of negative 0.4. Now, you probably won't ever have to do this, since you can easily find both positive and negative z tables, or you can even use online calculators that will simply tell you the percentage of scores associated with any z-score without having to look across rows and columns. But doing this helps you to think about what z-tables are showing conceptually. And it can serve as a reminder that the curve is perfectly symmetrical. And hopefully, this gives you a more firm grasp on the idea of z-scores. In addition to being able to find the percentage of scores that fall below or above a particular z-score, we can also use a z-table in order to find the percentage of scores that falls between two z-scores. And so, in order to do this, all we have to do is find the percentage of scores that fall below the higher z-value, and then subtract the percentage of scores that fall below the lower z-value, and then this will give us the percentage of scores that falls between those two points. For example, let's say that we wanted to know how many scores fall between the z-scores of minus 1.32 and positive 2.14. So first, we'd find the percentage of scores that fall below positive 2.14. And if we look in the table, this would be 0.9838. Next, we'd find the scores falling below a z-score of minus 1.32. And this is 0.0934. And if we subtract 0.0934 from 0.9838, we would get 0.8904. And this would mean that 89.04% of scores in a normal distribution will fall between a z-score of minus 1.32 and positive 2.14. And as a reminder, this means that if we randomly select a score from the population, it would have an 89.04% chance of falling somewhere between these two z-scores. Of course, if we want to do this for raw scores, assuming we believe we have a normally distributed population, then we have to convert them to z-scores. So let's say that we're looking at a distribution of IQ scores with a population mean of 100 and a standard deviation of 15. I might ask, what's the probability that a randomly selected person from the population will have an IQ between 90 and 110? To figure this out, first, we need to convert these raw scores of 90 and 110 into standard deviation units, or z-scores. So the formula for a z-score is the raw score minus the population mean divided by the standard deviation. So for a raw score of 90, this would be 90 minus 100, or minus 10, divided by 15, equals negative 0.667. And for 110, it would be 110 minus 100, or 10, divided by 15, which would equal positive 0.667. Now we can look up these z-scores in the table and see how many scores fall below each. In this case, we'll have to round our value of 0.667 to 0.67, since this table only goes to two digits after the decimal place. And if I look in the tables, I'll find that for a z-score of positive 0.67, we get a value of 0.7486. And for a z-score of negative 0.67, we'll have a value of 0.2514. So if I subtract 0.2514 from 0.7486, I'll get a result of 0.4972, meaning that approximately 49.72% of scores would be expected to fall between the raw IQ scores of 90 and 110. Or we could say that there's about a 49.72% chance that a randomly selected person from the population would fall into this range of 90 to 110 for their IQ. Okay, so I hope this helped you to understand how to use a Z-table and what it's used for. Let me know in the comments if this was helpful. Ask other questions that you still have. Be sure to like and subscribe, and check out the hundreds of other psychology and statistics tutorials that I have on the channel. Thanks for watching.